super furry animals. And hello, sunshine. It's Janice Long with you on BBC Radio Wales until 10 o'clock. And in a moment, you'll hear my chat with Noel Hogan, Mike Hogan and Fergal Lawler from the Cranberries. And of course, we will be remembering Dolores. And I thought it might be quite interesting to pop in a couple of snippets, actually, from an interview I did with Dolores back in 2009. OK, wake me when it's over, the Cranberries. So Wake Me When It's Over, that's a new single from the Cranberries from the wonderful album In The End. And please welcome Noel Hogan, Mike Hogan and Fergal Lawler. How are you?
Hey, good.
Fergal, last week we actually did a Q&A, didn't we?
Yeah.
It was good, wasn't it, though?
Yeah, it was good. Nice and relaxed. That's the way to have it.
I loved it because the people who were there in the audience and the people who phoned in, you have been a soundtrack to their lives, which is really interesting, isn't it, to find out that, you know, you're their diary.
Yeah. I mean, if for us, that's probably, especially in the last 12 months since Dolores passed away, it's been the biggest buzz, is to hear these stories of how the songs are kind of markers in their lives about what song means such a thing to them and how it helped some people even. And you never think of that when you're writing songs and you're playing them. You just kind of, you're getting on with your daily chores or, of doing it. And then, you know, it's great to kind of meet people. And that's what's great about doing these face-to-face things, where you get to talk to people and hear their stories. And it makes it all worthwhile, really.
And Mike, making the album, it's been a very positive thing, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has. I mean, we didn't wait long to go into the studio after Dolores passed away, after we listened to the hard drive. The demos were on the hard drive, so we'd listen, and kind of went in April last year. So it was actually emotional enough, it was, like, for us. But I think it was, but at the same time, it was kind of therapeutic as well, like, to kind of go in and put the tracks down, and took our minds off it a bit as well, like. So I mean, it was Stephen Street's idea to get in there pretty quick and get moving on it as well.
Well, I think, you know, that's wonderful that you reunite with Stephen Street, because surely he gets you.
Yeah.
What was it like sort of walking in? I mean, it can't be long before you feel comfortable with somebody like Stephen, because you've worked with him and because you were such a fan of him, his work that he'd done with the Smiths, the Cure, various other people. You always wanted him, didn't you?
Yeah, we asked our A&R guy at the time, you know, they were like, who do you want to do the album? And we took a real gamble, thinking there's no way he's going to do this, but we asked anyway. And he only told us, actually doing this album, that he had seen us play the Marquee like months beforehand. And he said there was just something there, he couldn't put his finger on it, but he liked it and felt that he could work with it. So then coincidentally we called him, well, we didn't, DNR people did. And we tried a week, a trial, and it clicked straight away. I mean, like, day one. And we were a bit intimidated going in, because it's, you know, it's Stephen Street and he had done all this stuff. And if he's listening to this now, he'll be like, oh, my head. But we formed this friendship that has lasted nearly 30 years with him now. I mean, sometimes we think of him as almost the fifth member of the band.
Of course, yeah. Of course. You say 30 years. I mean, you know, there you were, these kids in Limerick, wanting to make music. Was there a scene in Limerick at the time?
There was lots of local bands in Limerick, and I think that's what kind of made us pick up instruments, because we were into music, we were into, like, The Cure and The Smiths and New Order and that kind of stuff. And when we saw these local guys that we kind of recognised from around town playing in bands, we kind of said, geez, you know, maybe we should get some instruments and give it a go. So, you know, that's what we did.
Did you all gravitate then to your own instruments? I mean, Mike, did you immediately go to a bass?
Yeah, I actually had interest in the drums, but Fur got there before me.
Yeah,
so I was a bit gutted with that one, like, but sure, you know, but then, you know, the throne calling came then, like, it did, you know.
And you, Noel, did you feel that you wanted to do the guitar and be instrumental in the songwriting process?
No, honestly, I got the guitar because they were already playing drums and bass. It was the only instrument left. And the songwriting thing for us, you know what? We weren't good enough to do cover versions, so we made up our own songs. And that's how that began. We knew a few chords, And then, you know, it was like, let's make up songs. And that was really how this began for us. And we never really bothered with doing cover versions then till years later, till we were became better musicians. So by the time we met Dolores, we kind of stockpiled a bunch of songs. Say Linger was one of them.
Mm.
And that was the final piece of the puzzle, as I said. Then when Dolores came in, and, you know, we gave her a cassette with the music on it, and she came back later in the week with the version of Linger, really, you know, that practically finished version that everyone knows today, was the one that was written that first week with her.
And that must have been mind-blowing.
Mm.
Yeah, like, it was hard to hear her vocal. You could hear the melody and you knew she could sing, because the equipment we had was really dodgy, you know.
Ropey.
She was plugged into my guitar amp, so if you turned up the guitar, the vocal got...
just distortion, yeah, on it.
But when we did those first demos and you could really hear her properly, you know, a couple of months later, I mean, we were blown away, because not only did she do the top line, suddenly she goes, I got some backing vocal ideas, and next of all this range of those high vocals and lows, you're going, where did this come from? Mm. So, I mean, it was really hairs in the back of your neck time, you know, standing up. And I think that's the moment we knew there was something here different.
So what did you do to say, right, you're in?
Oh, yeah. Well,
she was in the first week when she came back.
Yeah.
And, you know, yeah, we were delighted because she could actually sing. And,
and she came
that's
back.
All we wanted. And she came back again.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I just see her as this icon in many, many ways. You know, she's a feminist icon, and she's such a gifted, you know, musician. People might not realise she can play many instruments. Mm. Great lyricist, and she just had so much going for her that being in the studio, there must have been such fun moments. And some prickly moments as well.
Yeah, but there was the moment, because our system of recording as time went on was... Dolores didn't like to kind of sing a song over and over, because she felt she'd lose the passion for it. So when technology finally came around to the fact that we could put down some guide vocals in the morning and she could go away for a day or two and come back, start coming in the evenings then. But the kind of hairy moment was when she'd come back first and go, let me play me what you've done for the last few days. So you're playing these ideas that, you know, we've been working away on, and you're looking at her going, hope this fits in now, because sometimes what you do might clash with the vocal, and she might have a backing vocal idea that you haven't heard yet. So there'd be that moment where you're kind of waiting for the reaction, and most of the time it was like she'd love it, but, you know, there were moments where she'd go, I don't think that's going to work or whatever. And yeah, we had a system of working, and it worked well for us for a long, long time.
Well, we'll talk more about the album in a moment, but we'll play the title track from it. Mm-hmm. And I find the lyrics quite interesting. Strange, when everything you wanted was nothing that you wanted in the end. And I remember talking to Dolores many years ago about how she sometimes felt that you get all of this stuff, you have this success, and, you know, you go on these tours, which all sounds incredibly exciting, and I'm sure it is at first, but there are moments when you desperately want to get home.
Ain't it strange when everything you wanted was nothing that you wanted in the end? Ain't it strange when everything you dreamt of was nothing that you dreamt of in the end?
Right now, right, this is the most tranquil and peaceful place I've ever been in my life. You know, I have a lot of peace of mind. The kids are amazing. I'm so glad that I took all the time off and went away from the music to have them. Mm. Because there's a lot more to life than fame and success and money and all that stuff. At the end of the day, it's only love that really brings us through, you know. Mm. So, and I got to that point as well where it was like, what's it all for though?
Mm.
What's the point in having a house like if you're going to pay 10 people to live in it and run it, and you're out there singing for your supper morning, noon and night, you know? So you get older and you get a bit of sense and you learn how to say, look, I'll only take what I need. I'm not going to think that having loads makes you happy, because it doesn't. There's only so much we need, and there's only so much we can have. At the end of the day, it is really important to have friends and family and loving times and quality in life.
strange when everything you wanted was nothing that you wanted. Strange when everything you wanted was nothing that you wanted in the end.
In the end, from Cranberries, and that is the title track from the album. So heartbreaking. Dolores dies, and I remember being on the air when the news came through, and it was such a shock. And obviously to you, that's just going to knock you for absolute, you know, six. The shock must have been awful. And you have that process to go through, grieving process. You try to go through, you might not have even finished going through that yet. But then all of a sudden you start thinking that, well, hang on, we've got some tunes here. We've got bits and pieces. What can we do with them? So what happened?
Yeah, I guess, like, we kind of all went to ground really for the first couple of weeks, because obviously there's this sudden attention on the band again, and a lot of it, look, the outpouring was amazing to see, the reaction all over the world.
It was.
But, you know, you're just not in a place where you can be talking to anyone about these kind of things. So, you know, we spent time at home, then the funeral came and went, and then things get quiet because people move on with their lives. But we suddenly realised there's something here that we haven't kind of looked at yet, and it is these songs. So over kind of, I guess, the end of February, we started patching it together, you know, getting the vocals and getting the demos up. And then over the space of a week or two, you suddenly realise, hold on a minute, these songs are actually really good. This is a very strong album, especially when you put it all in a playlist together and you listen to it back to back. Even though there were only demos at the time, it still felt like something special. So once we kind of spoke together and we thought, yeah, we should finish this, we then spoke to her family, and they were, you know, they were delighted to hear that we were going to do it. And they gave us their blessing and said they wouldn't get involved, just they trusted us to do what we do. And the last piece again then was to contact Stephen and see how he'd feel about it. And he kind of dropped everything he was doing and said, yeah, but we should do it now, he felt, because that raw emotion was there.
Yeah.
And I think he's right, you're looking back, because he said, you know, you could come back to this in a year and not want to do it. Whereas now, you've spent time getting these demos together, and you've listened to it, it's all fresh, let's just do it. And before we knew it, in April last year, we went in and started recording.
And it was a bit like a jigsaw in some ways, wasn't it? Because you were getting bits and pieces.
There was a drive in New York that her partner had, so he came over with it, because there was some of the tracks. We had a lot of the vocal, but we thought, oh, it's a pity she didn't finish that verse and things like that. Suddenly, when that drive arrived, all those bits were on there. She just hadn't gotten around to sending them. So, I mean, it was like winning the lotto when we found those. And those, all that, there's 11 tracks that are on this album are really the ones that were finished on those drives.
And what was it like then, Mike? Because it must sort of bring back memories. You know, there must be moments that you remember.
Yeah, of course.
When
you're doing it, it was quite emotional. You know, the first few days. But we kind of just, after we got the first couple of days down, we kind of got into it. Like, Steve was great as well to be there as a kind of a mediator, kind of to, you know, when we were feeling down, he'd kind of get, you know, come on, give it your best for Dolores and stuff. So it was great to have him there as well in the process of it. But yeah, it was quite emotional. But we knew we had something really good there as well, though, with the vocals were so good, you know.
And Fergal, do you think that it was beneficial to come away from Limerick to do it and do it in London?
I think so, definitely, just to get away from the spotlight and you know, to be over here, the three of us with Steve as well, because Steve was grieving as well, obviously, because he was so close to Dolores. So to have the four of us together in a room kind of expressing our emotion on this record is definitely something that helped. At the time, you mightn't have noticed it, you know, we mightn't have felt that, but looking back upon it, it was kind of like, okay, I'm glad we did it. You know, it was draining. I remember for the first week or two after I got home from finished recording, I was wrecked. I had to kind of go to sleep for an hour in the afternoon, kind of thing, just completely drained. But looking back in it, I'm glad we did that, you know, because we were together, going through it together. It was nice.
And the great thing is that her mum, Eileen, actually gave it the thumbs up. Yeah, when she heard it.
But you know as well how positive Dolores was about doing the album as well. Like, so it was a big thing to do.
Lost. I love this track because her vocals, I think, are very special on this track.
They're amazing. I mean, she sounds so vulnerable at the beginning of this, and even I remember when I first kind of put everything up for the demo, and it was the vocal on its own with no music around it, and it was just really, you couldn't listen to it from start to finish for the first few days. Kind of, it was one you kept coming back to till you got it to a point that it was, you know, somewhat of a demo. But she sounds like, as I said, really vulnerable in the beginning, but then builds and builds to this huge crescendo at the end of it. I mean, it's really, it shows her vocal talents to their, at their best, I think, this track.
Okay, well, let's take a listen to it. This is Lost. That was Lost from Cranberries, and my guests are Noel Hogan, Mike Hogan, and Fergal Lawler. And I was saying before that she's iconic, and I love the fact that she had no fear, that she would comment on whatever she wanted to comment. She would be there, wouldn't she? And I'm thinking of the IRA bombings in Warrington. Tell us about the experience of that, Noel.
Like, that happened, and it was obviously huge news, particularly back at home. And
93, wasn't it?
It was around
February,
that,
March.
Yeah. And we were rehearsing, kind of writing and getting ready for whatever gigs and stuff. And she came in. I remember we had this tiny room where we used to rehearse, and I mean, it was really small. And she'd always kind of been saying to us, turn things down, you're too loud, I can't hear myself. But it was the one time she came in, and she started playing it on acoustics because I had this song. And we were kind of tipping away at it, not really going that aggressive. And it was the one time she turned around and said, no, this needs to be angry. This
is an angry song. And it is in the production and her delivery.
You know, this has pissed me off, basically. Yeah. And I want to get that across. So that was, you know, how it began. And even at the time, no matter how hard we were playing, it still wasn't hard enough for her, you know. So we kept going and going. And then obviously everyone knows the song now and the end result for it. And it, you know, it really shows the skill she had at writing songs, because some people don't know what that song is about, but they know it's an anti-war song.
Yeah.
Even though they don't know the situation that kind of started it. And what's amazing is all these years later, that song can be put in any context to do with things going on this planet.
Yeah.
And it still is relevant because of that. And I've heard it and seen it on loads of news broadcasts because of that. And, you know, it became this massive, bigger than anything we ever did, this song, to this day. I mean, it's, you say the Cranberries, people go, who? And then you say Zombie, and they go, oh, yeah, now I know who it is. So, I mean, it's a credit to her, that song.
Let's remember it. This is Zombie. Zombie from the Cranberries, and my guests are Noel Hogan, Mike Hogan, and Fergal Lawler. It's, you know, 40 million record sales. It's phenomenal, isn't it? And it's going to increase, obviously. It's just going on and on. Did you ever imagine that?
No. When we started...
No.
We were, you know, just four kids from Limerick playing our instruments and hoping to get some local gigs, and... You know, then we got some local gigs and we kind of sent off our demo. We had a demo recorded just for ourselves so we could hear it properly. And some of our friends said, why don't you send it away to record companies? And we said, okay, why not? And then we got a call from Jeff Travis.
Oh, he's great.
And, you know, he said, we'd love to see you play. You're coming over to London. We couldn't afford to go outside Limerick, really, you know. So it was a few months before that happened, and yeah, we kind of played some college gigs, and then eventually started getting some attention from different people, and you know, it took it slowly, but we worked hard. We played a lot and toured a lot, and especially after we got signed, and we kind of really like toured a lot of clubs, and
you served your apprenticeship basically, yeah. Didn't you? You really did.
Because getting signed is only the beginning. People forget that the real work starts then.
Yeah.
Because you know, you do an album, so what? I mean, it's getting out there and doing the tours and pushing it. Like we said yes to everything. Some things we're not proud of, you know. but we did it.
We actually drove one time from we drove from Limerick. We got the boat across the Irish Sea, drove up the north.
Yeah.
Got the boat across to Scotland and drove to Wick. I mean, it's just before John O'Groats, I think. Drove all the way up and we told, it's going to be a great festival, we were told, and there was like five people.
No.
And after driving all the way up, and we were like, should we just, you know, it was kind of...
2 days.
We still enjoyed it, like, turning the beer afterwards. Oh. Yeah. Yeah.
But just, look, it's great, it's a good learning curve, and it's you serve your time. It's like an apprenticeship, really.
Yeah. Remember.
You know, all that gigging made us so tight as a band. Because when we went in to do the second album, we'd been touring a lot. I mean, we flew through the recording process. We were just...
Yeah.
Even Stephen was kind of shocked at the difference between the first and second album. The way we were able to just lock in with each other.
And that second album just... I mean, America. Yeah. Well, the Americans all think they're Irish.
Yeah.
Don't they? Yeah. But you were just whoosh, you were out there, weren't you? Catapulted.
We were touring. We were actually doing a tour in Europe with the Hot House Flowers. Supporting them for about 3 weeks, and we thought we were going home at the end of that, and we got a call in from the direct company in the States saying, "Come on over, because it's at our taking off on college radio." And we went over there, and we couldn't believe it. We were doing like two shows a night and stuff, and just took off all of a sudden.
Well, the thing was, you were doing two because you were so popular.
Yeah, exactly. So the club would empty out, more people would come in. Like, and then when you were at the hotel, it was constantly on MTV and everything. Like, it was shocked.
Now, is this the hotel where you raided the minibar?
No.
We were still doing the first album.
You've got to tell that story. Yeah. Please tell that story. I love it.
Were we mixing the first album out in Surrey?
It was Maison Rouge. Fulham Road.
Fulham Road.
And we had very little experience in real hotels. You know, we had a lot of sleeping on floors.
Kips, I suppose. Yeah. Staying in Kips before. Yeah. And this is the first decent hotel that we were in.
So the first day we get there and we go, there's a bar. We all ringing each other going, there's a bar in the room. There's like a fridge full of beer. And so that's fine. So the first night we go and we do whatever we're doing. We all meet in one of the rooms. We fill the pillowcase each with what's in the fridge, bring it down, drink it, go to bed, come back the next day from the studio and the fridges are full again. And honest to God, we thought,
this is unreal. This is
a service.
Best hotel ever.
You know? And this went on for about 10 days or something. And every night we'd clean the bar out, or, you know, the mini bar, and they'd fill it the next day. Just thought this was a gift. We were like 1920, and
you weren't used to that kind of thing.
And we had a friend living here who used to call around, and what we couldn't drink we'd fill up in a pillowcase and give him to take home. So that was all fine until we had to actually check out, and the record company were covering the rooms. That's fine, we go down to check out, kind of hand in our keys, go, thanks, we'll see you. And then guy goes, hold on, there's some incidentals to be paid here.
What's that?
There's the bones of 2 weeks of four mini bars to be paid for. Panic stations.
Over now, and that's the Cranberries from the album In the End. My guests are Noel, Mike and Fergal from the Cranberries. And when you first heard, or we first heard that, it sounds quite prophetic, doesn't it? But it's not. Mm-hmm. It's actually about that period of my life is over.
Yeah.
I think because we hear the hotel room and all that, oh my goodness,
sure,
like,
yeah,
hang on. But it's nothing to do with that.
No, I think it's something from her, Dolores' past, you know, it was an incident that happened in her past, and she was kind of getting that out there and putting it behind her. That's the way she kind of, it was like a form of therapy for her. If she had something stressful going on in her life, she'd write about it. It was on paper, put it in the past and move on to something new. And that's actually where she was in the last year of her life. She was in a positive place because she had kind of expelled a lot of demons and was looking forward to a new part of her life. She had just bought a house outside Limerick and was shopping for furniture like the weekend before she came over here.
Sad, isn't it? It really is. You're going to continue doing obviously interviews about, you know, you, the Cranberries, but you're not going to tour, are you?
No, unfortunately. It's just not possible without Dolores. So, and it's probably our biggest kind of regret about this album is that we don't get to do it live or hear it live, or, you know, because for us, we've done that before we ever recorded anything. We've been playing live, and it was just that natural progression of do this, you know, record it, and then that transition from the recording to the live was always exciting to see how it would change the songs a bit. And it's sad that we don't get to do that. Like, we've really only played these songs one time, and that was to record them. So, you know, it's unfortunate, but it's kind of a catch 22, really. You can't, you know, there's no way around it.
But you have got lots of footage.
Yeah, yeah.
And what are you going to do with that?
Yeah, there's talks of a documentary. We were originally doing a documentary for, you know, from when the band started up to the first album, and there's some footage there of Dolores being interviewed for that as well. So hopefully we're going to add more stuff to that and hopefully try and do a documentary.
But it'd be great for people to see, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it'd be great. Fantastic, yeah. So,
But I imagine the process of that is that going to be quite long, though.
Yeah. At a guess, I'd say 2 years, because there's 30 years of material to start to glue together. That, and, you know, we've been approached by different production companies, and, you know, and we haven't even made the decision whom we're going to go with yet, or what way this, you know, how it will begin and how it will end and all that. So,
because you really want to have a say in it.
Yeah, what we think is somebody's going to do this, and probably badly, so we should be the ones to kind of do it right. So we'll take our time and we'll get it done, and it'll be worth the wait, I think, in the end.
I think that's what the Cranberries have always done, taking their time, if you think about it. I mean, you know, there have been hiatuses, but that's not, that's added to your keeping going
and
bringing exciting new things to the table every time you get back together.
That's it, yeah, because, you know, we learned to take breaks, I think, after our third album, that we were burnt out completely, and we kind of said we never want that to happen again. You know, you want to enjoy doing what we're doing, you know, and get that fresh feeling again, you know. And after a year or two off or whatever it might be, you start to miss each other and kind of want to play again, and then the phone calls start, the emails start, and then you get back in the rehearsal room, and it's just like you never finished, you never stopped, took a break. It's just like immediately click back into it.
And what I love about the whole thing, Mike, is that the love of the fans never goes away. Globally.
No, it's been amazing. I mean, because we took that long break for 6 or 7 years, and we thought, you know, when we got back together, we'd be going back doing clubs and stuff. And, but I mean,
Irish show band.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's it. But I mean, like the fans were all still there, and it was amazing. It was like, we couldn't believe that, you know.
Obviously the thing for you, I mean, you will have other projects, I'm sure, on the go at some point, but obviously it's that beautiful person that's gone out of your life.
Yeah, that's the thing, I guess. There's the public side of Dolores that everybody kind of knows, but for us it was our friend as well, you know. And you do, there's barely a day would go by that you don't think of her or miss the bizarre phone calls in the middle of the night. You know, kind of things that, you know, at the time you wouldn't appreciate, but now you miss them, that they're not there. You know, and I suppose that's a normal thing with anyone who loses somebody, you know, but it just, I guess for us, there's the friendship and the amount of work we did together to be able to create these songs and have that. The way, I guess, the positive is we have a great legacy, I think, left behind. That the band, you know, will be gone, but these songs will live on and on and on for a long time.
Of course, well, she'll never be forgotten.
No.
You know, like, no. But you won't. You'll never be forgotten, because those songs were always be played. And I must say that on the album cover, in the end, most beautiful artwork depicting you. I mean, it's not you, it's relatives of yours, but depicting you as kids.
Yeah, yeah.
Who came up with that idea?
It was Callie, our art director, who worked with us in the first three albums. Yeah, we didn't know what to do with the cover, you know. We kind of had been thinking about it and talking about it for a while, and, you know, I kind of, once we had the album recorded, we kind of said, oh yeah, that's it now, you know, the hard work is done. But there was lots of other stuff we kind of had forgotten about, like videos and covers and stuff like that. So Callie said, I have this idea of maybe getting kids that are related to you in some way and putting them on the cover to kind of represent you when you were younger, but also the new generation of Cranberries fans who are starting bands and that.
It's absolutely gorgeous. I'm trying to looking at you going, which one is it? Yes, which one? But no, it's a fantastic cover and a wonderful album in the end. And I do hope our paths cross again.
Yes, yes,
it's been lovely meeting you. And what should we go for? The final track, The Pressure, Crazy Heart, Catch Me If You Can, Illusion. What do you fancy?
Illusion.
Illusion. Yeah, let's play Illusion. Yeah. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.
Remarkable. That's the Cranberries from the album In the End. That track is Illusion. And once again, thank you very much indeed to Noel and to Mike and to Fergal for taking the time. It must be incredibly painful for them. It's like scratching at a wound, isn't it? The fact that, you know, as I said, she was their colleague and dear, dear, dear friend. 07 in the waiting line. No, 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 no.